I would like to start to introduce our first speaker of the day, who is a guy, I'd call him a friend actually. I've known him for many, many years now, Joep Driessen. So a little bit of background about Joep. He qualified as a vet in 1994 from the University of Utrecht, spent 2 years in dairy practice, vet practice. He then spent 6 months on a 14,000 cow dairy unit in Saudi. He founded VetVice together with his colleague Jan Hulsen in 97, then founded CowSignals training company in 2007. He's developing people signals action model. It's that action word again. Hopefully you're gonna hear it a lot today. How to motivate farmers, how to make a change, how to make a difference for farmers, but also advisors like me. He's active in over 55 countries, and he's got over 500 certified CowSignals trainers across the world, of which Mole Valley's got around about 18 of those. He lives together very happily with his wife, Annalise, the boss, and his wonderful three children. So, ladies and gentlemen, may I introduce Joep Driessen.
Thank you. Thank you. Who's a farmer in here? Who's actually milking cows? Hands up. Okay, most of you. Who's not a farmer? Hands up if you don't milk cows. Well, they're on that section there, so I better focus on this area here. No, just kidding. It's for farmers and advisors. I think we have a very nice story for you. I first want to tell you the story how it started. I was born on a dairy farm in Luxembourg, and then my dad moved back to Holland, where we had a sheep farm. And when I was 10 years old, my dad said, come, Joep, you have to help me because there's a sheep lambing and you've got nice little hands. Well, that was before I was this age. And he had big hands, so he couldn't get in. So you have to help me, he says, okay, let's see what we can do. So I went down on my knees in the sheep in the straw yard and trying to get a baby out, a bit of a puzzle, one baby out, another baby out. And I was very proud. I was a vet already, 10 years old. I was standing up, and I looked at my knees. And I had two wet knees. And my mom, she saw it, and she said to my dad, hey, Joep, you have to put more straw in here because it's too wet. Look at this, it's just too wet for my baby lambs. They get born on a wet straw pack. It's wet and dirty. And then my dad said, no. This is good enough because it costs money and it's still overwork. My mom was a nurse and she was taking care of the four kids in the family and taking care of the excess baby lambs and giving them the bottles and the buckets. And she worked in hospital as a nurse. My dad was studied on the Agriculture University of Utrecht. He was a agriculture economist and grassland specialist and he was always in the top 5% of the sheep farms, the top 5% benchmark. He was making money with his sheep. So that dilemma between that quarrel above my head as a little kid from my mom and dad about more straw, less straw, more straw, it was actually the dilemma of taking care of the animals and taking care of the money. And that dilemma is in every farmer's head. Yes, I want to take care of my animals, but I also have to earn some money. So when can I invest? How much can I invest? We still have to eat. And that dilemma I discovered is no dilemma at all. And we discovered after a few workshops that there was no dilemma. So I went to vet school and I still had to do a few years of education to get a vet. I met Jan Hulsen, he's the author of all our books. And we even the first cow we had together was this cow. And we teach her to read the book. And the good thing, it's all picture books. And we have a lot of pictures in our books, and the picture books are easy to read, even for a cow, right? And that's the textbooks I always used on school. You can pass this one on to have a little look at it. So then I went in practice, 2 years of practice, and I passed by many cows looking for the horrible diseased cows and doing some fireman work trying to fix sick cows. But after 2 years, I was sort of stopped by this cow. I was passing this cow many, many times by not looking at her because I had to find a very sick cow. But then I suddenly stopped at her and I looked at her and I think, hey, what are you trying to tell me? And you know what she said? She was trying to tell me something. She said, help me. She needs help. And I never realized that this is not a normal cow. It's a cow which is sick, almost sick, a little bit subclinical. She's not getting anywhere. She's not making money. And what were these signals she was showing me? She shows me 10 signals. And I'd like you to discuss with your neighbor now for 1 minute. Do you see the 3 major signals? And do you see all the 10 signals on this cow? It's all about observing cows. So you got 1 minute to write down or to tell your colleague next to you, what signals do you see? And what is the top 3 signals? 1 minute. A bit up. How's it going? So it's better? Yeah. Okay, what is the first signal that you see? The first signal, what's this cow telling you? Not happy, and she's not being milked, she's not eating and not resting. So it's actually a waiting cow, and she doesn't look happy, right? So what are the signals that you can tell she's not happy? What's the first thing you see on this cow? Yeah, the way she's standing, very good. She has a sore feet, and a lot of people don't see that because that is immediately the most important signal. And we sort of didn't get it on the picture because this leg is just a little bit tipped up like this. And that's where you have to look. If the cows don't stand with 4 feet on the ground, this is the first signal of infectious disease, mostly it's infection. And after infection, very quickly the other leg gets overpressured. So we have infectious disease, overpressure, and the cow is lame. And because the cow is lame, you get all the other 9 signals on this cow. But lameness is the ultimate cause of the disaster, of all the disease you get in your dairy farm because cows don't eat. How do you see that? She's not eating. Rumen fill. If you see a shadow and the book is passing by with rumen fill here in the book, you see like scores 1 till 5. You can have a quick look yourself. 1 is empty, 5 is full. And that's one of the first things we were learning farmers 15 years, 18 years ago. If you see a shadow here, just under the short ribs, if the skin folds in, if it goes a little bit inside, that's an empty rumen. If it goes straight down, it's a 3, it's okay. But the best cows in the world are always going out right away. The skin folds out, it's like number 4. The best, most successful cows always have rumen score 3.5, 4. So that's the standard. But we see how much percent of the cows like this on a dairy farm? What do you guess? Well, not that bad. But somebody said 80. I would say I see 80% cows with 3 or more, but you see 20%, sometimes 30%, which have empty rumens, number 2, shadow. And that's really bad because they didn't eat for 6 hours. And we like every cow to eat every 2 hours to stay healthy. So everything you have to do is just seeing it and then do something about it. How can we make every cow eat every 2 hours? 12 times a day a meal. That's a challenge. What else do you see? Give me 10 more signals, 8 more signals. What else? A lump on her back. So she's finally trying to lay down, and then she's standing a bit longer and tap dancing, and she's moving. Yeah? You see it on a lot of farms. And then finally she's laying down, and bang! She's falling against the metal, and she's banging her backbone against the metal, the side metal dividers. Same happens with the hock. She's on the hock. She's rubbing her hock. What else? A few more signals. Sunken eyes. She didn't drink. So she didn't eat, and she didn't drink. You see deep eyes, and you see dull skin, and she has a bad hair day, you see? So it happens all the time. Another thing is, yeah, the ears are dropping, and some farmer was telling me this cow has heavy earmarks. They pull the ears down. Well, the cow's not happy. Heads go down, ears go down, eyes go deep. And this cow is suffering. She's not happy. She's lame and wounded, and she's afraid. You see the tension in the tail, that she's stressed from something. She can hardly move because it's painful. And now there's a photographer stressing her, too close to her, but she can't hardly move. So this was a bit of a shock after 2 years of practice. So I said, we have to do something better than this. And I signed, even with a hand on the Bible, in Ireland. I had to sign when I worked for a few months in Ireland. And I swear that I will take care of animal welfare. I didn't have to do it in Holland. I had to do it in Ireland. That was really eye-opener. I already started my business, but I really think I have to do something better now. We have to really take the next step and make cows live longer, let cows suffer less. For me, it really feels bad if I see a lame cow. I don't like lame cows because I was trimming a lot of them, helping them in the last stage of lameness. Finally, I could help them, and I was called as a vet to do the hoof trimming. I do a lot of hoof trimming courses. I did a lot of hoof trimming in the practice, teaching farmers how to do it. But then I said, I have to do something bigger than that. We have to work on healthier cows for the future. So today in the Netherlands, the half of the cows is suffering. It's maybe only once a year, but still, once a year mastitis is very painful. And 30%, in England probably 55% has mastitis. More than half the cows get a mastitis case per year. And that's not good enough, guys. And it's shocking, it's a hard reality, but you really, really want to do a better job on that. And how can you do that? It's not that difficult. We see also 50% subclinical milk fever. That means they don't eat enough around calving. They just don't eat enough. If they were eating enough, they didn't have lack of calcium. So how can we make that eating around calving better? We have 50% with bloody soles. It's amazing. Like if you look at hoof trimming in the first weeks, if you check, you only see it 2 months after calving, you see a red sole, normally caused around calving, right? Around calving, it goes wrong. So what can we do to have less milk fever, less bloody soles, and less mastitis, and less wounded hocks, and less lameness? So we asked the cow, and we looked at the cow, and this cow is asking you the question. You see? Question mark. And she says, just why don't we get what we need? And what we actually need is just a place to eat, and a place to rest, and a place to calve. That's the three things you have to think about in your dairy. How good is that organized? A place to eat, a place to rest, and a place to calve. That's the three things she's asking for. And a bit of light, air, and water, which is very cheap. So we started doing workshops in on farm. And we put 10 farmers out. This was 1999, the very first workshop. 10 farmers out on the feeding table, checklist, let's do it. Let's look at good and bad and the difference between cows. And just look, think, act, and trying to see see, hear, feel, and smell. Look for a percentage, like if you look at 5 cows, how many are ruminating? Another 5, hey, now I know it's 6 out of 10 or 7 out of 10, that's excellent. Empty rumens, you check 3 cows here and 3 cows there, and then you know a percentage. So check for a percentage. And look for you-knows. And you-knows are things that you want to know. You want to know what it is. It's a you-know, it's an unexplained, notable observation. You see it, but you don't know what it means. And that's where you learn from. And the waiting cows. The girl we just saw here, the waiting cow. She's not eating, you already said it. Not eating, not resting, not being milked. So what is she doing there? She doesn't make any money. And if she's... Cows really need to rest 14 hours a day, eat 6 hours a day, and if they don't match that, and the milking time is maximum 2 hours a day. And 2 hours of socializing and walking around, but it's walking around, not hanging around, standing on concrete. In a field, you always see the cows resting or eating. And most of you have grazing. Who has grazing still for more than 3 months per year? Hands up, who does grazing? Okay, who's not grazing, who's zero grazing? Only a few, eh? In Holland, we see now 80% of the robot barns have no grazing, but it's changing. More and more robot barns put options for grazing in the robot system because the cows really like to be outside. Waiting cows in the field, they always eat or rest, and they don't hang around. And in the barn, you also don't like them to hang around. It's not nice when they hang around. So we looked at the difference between good and bad. Good, bad, and we're trying to see the difference. And we actually made a very simple 3-score welfare check. It's about empty rumen, hocks, and lameness. So if you check only these 3 things, then you probably know what's going on. If you have more than 2 out of 10 in any of these 3 categories, you have to really work on health, welfare, and maybe training of your staff and of yourself. What can we do better? Because there's big money involved as well. It's not because I like cows so much. You remember my dad? Economics. My mom? Care. and I'm the crossbreeding product of these two. You know how it works, eh? So I'm on both sides. So we have a quick checklist, a quick scorecard. We used it yesterday on the farm, very nice farm. And we're checking the farm and we're trying to find out where are the easy wins. So you got 1 minute now to find the easy wins. This is your farm. What are you going to do tomorrow? And think about the feed, water, light, air, rest, and space. So look for all the signals that the cows are telling you and trying to look feed, water, light, air, rest, and space. These six things, what is lacking most? You got 1 minute. Let's go. Tell your neighbors, eh? Don't be shy. Okay, time is up. Time is up. No more sound. Ah, there's a sound. So if you look at this paper, what do you see? What are the cows telling you? Not enough feed space because it's one, two, three rows, a three-row barn, and then the feed space is limited. You said it's standing cows everywhere. How many waiting cows? Only one lying down, and they're all standing in the beds and hanging around the concentrate feeder. There's too many waiting cows. What else? What else do you see? The water is hidden, but there's water here and here, and that's only two drinkers for 60 cows. We saw the same on the barn yesterday. This was old school. This was how it is. How it was, but we really like to have a third drinker in the middle. So we want to have three drinkers for 60 cows to optimize water intake. So there's not enough water. And it's not in a feed space. What else do you see? A few more details. Nice to meet you. Dead end, well, they can walk around, but two-thirds of the cows are trapped in the back row. It's a very narrow back row and also very narrow here as well. So the cows cannot really get out and eat. And you really want them to eat 14 times a day, and it's not going to happen. And that's why you see 30% empty rumens. What else? Anything else? There's an interesting thing. You said feed. There's not enough feed space. But the biggest mistake that people make is not feeding the whole line, not using all the assets. You see that? And you ask yourself, why? And it's always a simple answer for it. There was one farmer telling me, yeah, I back up with my feed truck in the dead end feed alley, and then yeah, I actually brought a front deloader, so I can't feed all the way to the back. So I can't feed the last 5 meters. Bought a big mixer wagon. Okay, fair enough. But why are you not pushing it in if you come 2 hours later? Why don't you push the feed in this hole here? Yeah, I could do that. That's actually a good idea, he said. I was another farmer, and he was always backing up with his pushing truck, a little pushing truck, and then he was pushing the feed. But every time he was pushing the feed, this gap was getting bigger and bigger and bigger. I said, why don't you push forward if you drive in? Oh, that's actually a good idea. So you do things, and that's maybe the biggest value of cow signals, and I'd like you to go with one of our 17 cow signal trainers in the barn because that really works well. If you go with one of the Mole Valley guys, you get 10 farmers together and you do a workshop because then you open in your eyes. You don't see it anymore. If you work 1 year in a company, you get blind. So you really want to learn. You want to see everything. You want to try to see more, and if you see more, that can help you. Just spreading out the feet is one of the big tips. Spread out the feet. Of course, you want to have a crossover in the middle. You have to kick the wall out and put more water up. And, well, this space will never be bigger, but the biggest thing to do is probably making a deep, soft bed. We got three questions here. Is it just good stockmanship? Well, yeah, stockmanship is very interesting. Stress-free stockmanship is a big, big thing. I'll come back to that in a minute. Why are Dutch cows much healthier? I don't think they are. They're just better kept. Well, they're a bit better kept. We got like average of maybe 80 cows per 50 to 80 cows per farmer, I think, per staff member. And the robot barns, we have 120 cows per staff member. But I think we do a little bit better care, maybe. One of the things is that here you only scrape twice a day. In most farms, twice a day tractor scraping on a concrete floor. We have slatted floors and even cleaners on top of the floor, so they have they walk a lot less in the manure. So we have a bit less lameness and a lot less mastitis in Holland. The other question is, do they like to be outside? Even if you have a perfect barn inside, the cows still like to be outside. If they have only 2 weeks walking outside, we already see 10% less lameness in the next lactation. So walking outside gives them a relief. So I really want to have my dry cows in a walkout and give them exercise. They don't have to eat so much outside, but at least that they have a walkout exercise is really driving health. Although if you have a very good barn, the cows can choose if it's a lot of sun and a lot of rain, they'd rather be inside. So an insulated barn is a very good idea. Insulated roof that it can also shelter for the sun. It's a bit less of a problem in Scotland, but maybe a bit more here in the south. Does herd matter size? Well, size does matter, everybody says. The small herds, small herds per person, there's more attention to detail. The most happy cows live in Switzerland. Average herd size, 40 cows. Compulsory deep soft beds. No, not compulsory. Compulsory 1.95 meter long beds. And my trainers in Switzerland make the beds 2 meters because they say the cows are bigger than we think. They need a 2 meter resting place. So what we learned from the farmers is that we take care, if you take care of cows, you also take care of your wallet. Taking care of cows is taking care of yourself. So the dilemma, like my mom and dad were fighting about, there is no dilemma. And the farmers were telling us, the better you take care of your cows, the more you get. So these farmers were doing the workshop, looking at the cows, and they were changing. It was really a big success. And it was in 1999, in the first workshop. And we do it now for 18 years. A lot of people talk about breeding, but cows have a tremendous potential. Every Holstein cow in the world can now easily give you 10,000 liters, if you want. So the genetics is not the bottleneck. We have Ferraris, and we just passed one here. They can go very fast. They're like our top cows. They can do a tremendous effort. But if you drive them on a country road, you're not going to drive 200 miles an hour on a country road. And if you put fuel in the tank, diesel instead of fuel, you're not getting very far. And that's what happens in the industry now. We're so busy breeding. I like beautiful cows with good udders and good legs, but that's not the bottleneck anymore. So we have to see where the real bottleneck is, and that is the country roads and the fuel. We have to do a better housing and management and more attention to detail. Holy cow, another birthday. I want to have another birthday for all my cows, and I want my heifers to calve at 23 months. Why? Because it's possible. And why would you wait 4 months longer? It's 4 months extra feeding and crapping. A lot of manure and a lot of feed going down to waste and a lot of methane produced, greenhouse gases. So if you can cut 4 months off the rearing phase, it's a winner. So if you look at young stock signals, there's a lot to gain there too. If you look at the lifetime of the cows, what do you think is the average lifetime in the world? You can might use your toolbox if you like, but what do you think? What's the average lifetime in the world of a dairy cow in a house system or like half the year housed? 4 years, I think the average is probably 2.2 or 2.5, and this is a bit of an overestimation. In the full grazing systems, they got 4 or 5 lactations in New Zealand and Chile, but they only produce 4,000 liters, 4 or 5,000 liters. So they produce 25,000 liters lifetime production. In Holland, we are on 3.5, and 3.5 years of production with 9,000 liters, we are on 31,000 liters lifetime production. So the best 1% farms in the Netherlands, they are already on 5 lactations. And the very top is already on 6 lactations. So it's possible to go for 2 more lactations. And that's what we really want to do. We want to do 2 more lactations for every dairy cow in the world. And you see US, 2.2. California, 1.9. Sometimes, depends on the meat price. And 3.2 in UK, I think it's an overestimation. Some people say it's 2.9, some say it's 3.1. Anybody knows the figures? No? So it's, and well, it probably doesn't matter because what do you know? If you have the average, you still don't know anything. You want to have how much is on your farm, right? The average person, I learned this from Jack Rodenberg, the average person you don't know if it's a man or a woman, the average person. So the average person has one ball, one testicle, and one tit. So is the man or woman? Average doesn't say you anything, right? So don't think in averages. Double the lifetime is possible, so just try to double the lifetime. Two more lactations is possible, and I like you all to think about how you're going to reach that. And it's good for the farmer. Happy cows, happy farmers, and a happy world. Happy planet, happy milk. That's what we want to range. We want to reach. So we're going to do a little countdown. What do you think is the most efficient lactation number for a dairy cow? And we looked at almost 9,000 Dutch dairy cows with 100,000 liter. And we already had 23,000 of these animals in Holland in the last 20 years. So 23,000 cows were reaching the 100,000 liter in 10 or 11 lactations. So I like you to write down a number in your mind. Is it? It's not 1, it's not 11, but somewhere between 1 and 11. What do you think is the most efficient lactation for a dairy cow? If you look at all the top producers, when did they reach the top? And I like you to guess. So just stick up your hand if your number comes by. Who thinks it's 10, 9, 8, 7, stick up your hand, 6, 5, a lot of things you think 5, yeah, 4, who thinks 4, 10, 15 people, who thinks 3, yeah, only a few, and 2, 1, actually 1 is California, if you have 1.9 lactation, the first one is the highest lactation, but we got a winner because the man in the back, the very last man, he says 7 lactations, and we have like this very fancy CowSignals pen where you can actually do the little check. So we got a winner, Mr. 7 is here. Thank you very much. Big applause! Yay! Actually, the top is on 7. You see. So they are still growing for the first 4 years. So the 5 is a good guess, but 6 and 7 and 8 are the top. And then 9 and 10 is higher than 1 and 2. So why would you replace a heifer? Why would you replace a cow with a heifer? Even if the price is $1,000, Matt will tell you about it, the replacement cost can be very zero, can be zero sometimes. High meat price, $1,000 for a cull cow, $1,000 for a heifer. Wow. In Holland and England, there's 1,000 pounds difference normally between a cull cow and a new heifer. So you lose the moment you replace her, it's you lose $1,000 or 1,000 pounds. But even if the price was the same, sometimes in America with a good meat price, then you still lose how many liters? You change a 3-year cow with a heifer, you lose 2,000 liters. So that year you have 2,000 liters less. So it really pays back if you have happy old cows in your barn. Everybody's afraid for, yeah, fertility, mastitis. They all disappear, these problems, if you do a few things right. And we see it on our top farms with average of 5 lactations. They seem to do everything right and have a great respect for farmers because they work hard, they do a lot of good jobs, and they are in balance with the land. I really like farming. I come from the farming community. My dad was a farmer. And I appreciate very well that these top 1%, how they do it. And they have less work, they have a better life, they have more fun in their jobs because the cows don't get sick. So how can we reach that? The first thing we have to do is we have to make it easy for the cows to stand up. And if you think how big a cow is, how much space does a cow need to stand up? What do you think? How many feet do you need to get up? How many meters? What's that? 8 feet. 8 feet is 8 times 30 is 2 meter 40. Well, actually, the length of a cow, I already told you that it's like from here till here. If you measure cows from here till here, how much is that then? How many feet? But a lot of people think 6 feet. 6 feet. 180, that's the size of the mattresses. But the cows are 2 meter 10. We measure a lot of Holstein cows in the world. I measured a few yesterday. The bet was only 1.7, and the cow was 2 meters. And the big cows are 2 meters 10. So they like to have a bet of 2 meters 10. So there's always a compromise, a buy-off, how can you keep it clean? But the more space you give to the cow, the more resting time you get. The length of the cow is 9 feet long from the point of the nose till the tail. But now see what happens. Where is she going? Wow, another 70 centimeters, another 2 feet swing space. So we see that the cow needs 11 foot to stand up. So now you see this here. Look at this. This cow is trying to talk to you. You know what she says? Well, she says, help me, but she also says, shit happens. You see? So what is wrong here? What are the three things that go wrong? She can't move forward. She really wants to go through that wall. And if you see where she gets wounded, three, four places she gets wounded. Where do you see the wounds on this cow? The backbone, yeah. I let her stand up one more time for you. The backbone is banging. The hock is ribbing on the floor. The front leaves are crawling on the floor like this. Like they try. She's really trying to get up. And in the ultimate effort to stand up, she's whoosh, stepping on her own teeth. And the most teeth damage, I did a lot of stitching. 50% goes down the drain anyway, but we tried, so we saved the other half. I did a lot in 2 years practice. And people think, oh, other cows have been standing on it. No, most of the time it's the cow herself with her claw or dew claw ripping open her own teeth. Because it's the ultimate try. I have to get up now because I'm full of stress and somebody wants me to stand up and they have no headspace. So the biggest mistake why we ruin cows is this wall in front of the cows. They have to be easy. If they can stand up easily with very good grip, they will go 12 times a day for a meal and they don't get sick. It's as easy as that. So I don't believe in walls. So I sometimes say, read my lips, no more walls. Every wall is a mistake in every building. No matter where you are, no matter what weather you're in, we only need a roof. We have to bring the six freedoms of the pasture under the roof. And you can put a curtain up for 2 months a year if you really want to, or you can think about a design that you don't need it. You want to have maximum ventilation in your dairy shed. Maximum light, maximum air. And then no walls, because walls are always bothering the cow. You see this? This was 18 years of headbanging in Germany. Cows were, and they had nice, soft, deep straw beds, but they couldn't stand up. They had grip, but no space. And they were banging the wall every time they were standing up. And also they were looking for fresh air. Look at this. This was like breathing against the corrugated iron, and you're just rusting a hole in the wall after 15 years. Fresh air. Cows look for fresh air. Cows want to have head space and they want to have light. The Danish already knew it many years ago that you need at least 3 meters for a cow to stand up. We see that we need 3.35 meters for a cow to stand up. So a double row really works. But you want them to rest without head banging. So we need at least 9 foot here and 9 foot here. So 18 feet base, 5 meter 40 base. And then you have the maximum resting time. Every extra hour is 1 liter of milk. Every extra hour is 1 liter of milk from 9 to 15. And we measure the difference between 7 and 15 hours rest. If you check dry cow sheds, and we're doing great research now in Holland, my colleagues are doing that from Vetvar's research team. They have like collars, step counters, activity meters, and collars around the neck for eating time, rumination time, resting time, how many stand-ups. We know everything about the cow. And we see that the variation is huge in dry cows, 7 hours or 15 hours, even in heifers. In heifers coming in an overstock barn, so I'm a young heifer, I come in here, I think, oh my God, where do I go? And if there's not enough beds, slightly too little beds, the heifers only stand 7 hours. Sorry, only rest 7 hours instead of the wanted 14 hours. And that's how we ruin heifers. 20% of the heifers is leaving the system before they earn any money. In the first lactation, 20% is leaving your business. How can you do that? Because it's big money. It's just going down the drain. And it's all these little things you can do. Who has a heifer group? Who has a separate first lactation milking group? Hands up. Yeah. And how big is your farm? 400? Your farm? 300? Who else had it? 280 cows. So we see in Holland with 100 cows, the average is 100 in Holland. It's difficult. How is your housing set up? But if you have different groups, and one of the first things is a fresh cow group for the first 3 weeks, and then a heifer group, and then you can make production groups if you have more cows. But you have to do the first things first. If you can, a heifer group will give you 10% more milk from the heifers and less losses of these heifers. There's a lot you can do better. What do you see here? Just check this one. What's going wrong here? There's a pussy backbone wound here, a pussy open wound. Brand new barn, head-to-head, two row, not a three row, so very good, and a feed space. But he put mattresses in, and we don't like that too much. We want to have deep, soft beds. But the biggest problem here, what is it, the biggest problem? Too short, yeah. A lot of people think it's too narrow. Well, that's also the point. But if you make it more wide, it doesn't solve the problem. It only costs you more money to make them wider, but it doesn't solve the problem because you'll still go in even more. She's sticking over the edge, 30 centimeters, and she's hanging over the edge there, and she can't really get in. So look how your cows are resting in your system. And then actually by just, solution is always simple. Take this out, move to the front. Start with 10 beds. You have to start with a small step. Every small step you make, you think, hey, let's check. You can do your own little research in your own barn. I love that. I always talk farmers into one small change. Move the neck rail for eating further ahead in 10 bays and do the same. And the cubicles, just move the neck rail ahead or move this one ahead. But this one, the brisket locator, should be moved 20 centimeters ahead because or 30 even, because the cow is hanging over the edge. And that's are the three big success factors. After water, light, and air, which is very cheap, you also want to give feed, rest, and space. And first of all, the resting space, the Swiss make it 2 meter long. 2 meter long beds. Most happy cows live in Switzerland. They have a deep straw, chopped straw, with 1 kilo straw, 4 kilos limestone, and 1 liter of water. Just mix in your feeder wagon. So one straw, 4 limestone, and 1 liter of water. You mix it in a mixer wagon, and you can fill the beds. And you have a very cheap bedding, every week filling. You still have to clean it 3 times a day. Although you don't clean your floors 3 times a day, I still want you to clean the beds 3 times a day. If you do an extra cleaning round at noon, you will drop your cell count with sometimes even 40,000 cells by just one extra cleaning round. And you improve your resting time. So there's a lot of small things you can do. If you really know what to do, you can do it. Flexible neck rail here. And a stress-free calving area where the cow can stress-free calf. Very important. We make them behind robots, very small robot boxes that these cows can see the rest. So what are these three cows telling you? You see a little story of these three cows. What are they telling you? You always have to look at cow behavior. This is a stress-free calving line, 10 days before till 10 days after calving. The lame cow stays here for 3 weeks. The fresh cow sometimes stays here only for one day or 2 days. But they calf here, and then they go here as fresh cows. They can go to the robot by themselves, and that's not very common in England yet. But you have to use your robot also as an automatic cow selector, not only as a automatic milking machine. So who has a robot farm? Anybody? Hands up. Robot farms. See, yeah, 8 of them in the house. So you think about how you can make your life easier. What are these cows? This cow is telling you here. There's a standing cow, a waiting cow. What's she telling you? She says, I want to go and eat, but this lady is blocking my crossover. So never make a wall here. It's a mistake. Even this small little wall is a mistake because now she can't eat. And this one is also telling you a story. Hey, I'm alone. I don't like to be alone in a pen. It doesn't feel safe. You know, Tom is my friend, and I like to be with him in the car because we're friends. And we can have a talk and a lot of fun together. But if you're alone in a pen, I hate it. Sometimes I'm traveling around the world. I'm eating alone in the evening. I hate it. So then I FaceTime my family. If I'm lucky, I get some Wi-Fi. And then if I'm lucky, my daughters or my son, they're happy to talk with me for a while. Or we sometimes eat together, but they have lunch and I have dinner sometimes. It's funny how things go now. This cow says, I'm alone. I don't want to be alone. So I go as close as possible to this other cow here. Then I feel not so alone. So you never put a cow alone, and if it's a lot worse if there's a wall in here, because then she doesn't rest. You can have a perfect straw yard, but if you don't have it really open to eat, you're still losing it. Three things you need. You need a soft, deep bed for every cow, and that means 20 centimeters of sand, straw, or even manure solids. And then you need a stress-free calving line for 10% of the herd. And the third one is you need one feeding place per cow. A deep sand bed with one feeding place per cow of 70 centimeters. Heifer group, 65. Cow group, 75. Dry cow group, 85. Just remember, very simple. And actually up to 90 centimeters for dry cows. If you don't have enough space for the dry cows, they don't eat enough. What do you see here? They're resting. They're relaxed, they're laying down. And Yeah, a very good observation. They're still too narrow. This is really a Dutch disease. The biggest Dutch disease, the blindness for, we have to make them narrow because it costs money to make them from 115 to 125. But they have to be 125. Very good observation. They still rub their bars too much. They get away with it because they're so soft they can fall down straight without hurting themselves too much. And the good thing of sand is that excellent grip on the floor. And this is from Bert Jan, my colleague, you'll hear after lunch. He also, the urine floats to the middle and you have very dry walking space. This is just fantastic if you see these barns. There's always pros and cons and how do you keep the floor clean enough and what about the scraper, blah, blah. But you really, you see, this is probably the best barn you can ever build. Very simple two-row system with sand beds. Two more things for success. Hoof signals. We already talked about young stock signals going from 27 to 23 months calving and half your dead losses in the baby calves because you're losing 20% baby calves because of, well, silliness or ignorance. And somebody told me, if you think ignorance, if you think education is expensive, try ignorance. The price of ignorance is huge. And I see it everywhere. You lose 20% of your baby calves just before they start calving even. So from dead born till calving, till they're ready at 2 years. And then you lose 20% of your heifers in the first lactation. So 40% of your assets are going down the drain. Just think about it. So only the 60% has to make your money. So if you look at it from a bird's eye perspective, and you look at it at the industry, you think, wait a minute. Why are all these cows getting sick in the first 3 weeks? Why are we losing so much here and here? It's not right. So you have to look at a different way to your own farm and think, where is it going wrong? And they can all be very simply, well, not very simple, they can all be changed. It's just a matter of doing the right things. And if you look at hoof signals, we have books, video learnings, live trainings. The whole Mo Valley team was trained last year with on hoof signals. Four hoofs, four legs for better hoof health. First of all, excellent hoof quality. That means three times a year, hoof checks. And also the heifers at 22 months. Who's checking the heifers at 22 months? Anybody? Check them before calving, the heifers. Lift up some legs. Who's doing that? Who's lifting up the heifers' legs before calving? Nobody? Oh, of course. There's always a few, you see? And these guys doing it. And I ask every time, how many do need some trimming? Quite a few, roughly 50%. It's a bit of overgrowth, a bit of infection. And you, how many? Not many needs, but you lift them up anyway. It's also a good stress-free stockmanship training. You get them in your hand, and you just clean a little bit, you spray a bit, and you might have 20%, you might have 50%, depends on your housing system. But we see that heifers really need to have a good start. If you want to lose less heifers, start hoof trimming. Good hoof quality, number one. Number two, early effective treatment. You see cows standing, you really have to have them. You write down the number after milking, you treat her. That is the professional farmers. The best farmers in the world are hoof trimmers. Dutch hoof trimmers went to Denmark, bought a farm, and they're doing an excellent job on hoofs. And they make money. They grow. They had no farm, never. They were not farmer's sons, even they become a hoof trimmer. And then they learned how to be a farmer. But they started with one big thing. Always in time hoof trimming and prevention. The two other big things are, we already talked about it, infection and pressure. Infection, pressure. And you don't want to have infection and you don't want to have pressure. So what are you going to do? Well, a lot of things you can do, but we're going to talk about that maybe next year. Stress-free stockmanship is another big thing. And it's very simple. Stress-free stockmanship is never come in the flight zone of the cow and never go straight behind the cow because she can't see you. If you go walk up to a cow to get her out of the cubicle, the moment she's reacting, you step back and she can quietly stand up and walk out. If you just change that, train all your staff how to get cows to the parlor, 1 more liter of milk. On several farms, 2 more liters of milk. Unbelievable. The stress-free stockmanship has a huge impact. We made a very nice video and training on this. It's just about the simple realities. If you go too close to a cow, you stress the hell out of them. I shouldn't do it with Me Too girls, but it's very stressful. So if you come too close, the cortisol level goes up. You have heartbeat, goes faster. And then it takes a half an hour to calm down again for this cow. So a half an hour, no rumination. So you're losing rumination time. So never stress a cow. Don't come into the flight zone. And then the other lesson is, if you are very close to them, finally she moves for you, and then you step back 1-2 steps and wiggle a little bit so she can see you. If you stand still, she can't see you very well. So learn to see the reaction of the cow and learn to step back. Simple things. You can do it. Try this at home. You'll love it. We wrote a healthy cow guideline. You can find a lot of stuff on our website about all these things. We learned another thing. Farmers listen to farmers. So farmers don't listen to advisors, or they don't listen very well to advisors. I see a lot of farmers smiling now. Is it right? If you say they don't act very well, if an advisor tells you something, you don't react, you don't act. You think, well, yeah, you've easy for you to say that, but if your colleague says it, hey, wait a minute, hey, these guys, I started trimming my heifers. It's actually a very good idea because I have a lot less heifer lost, a lot less heifers losing in the first lactation than you, and it really works. Then you might think about it. And if the second farmer tells you this, hey, I do it as well, and then you're very proud because you made a very good decision on farmers' information. And that takes a lot of talking from advisors to get you doing these things. And I realized that this was the case. So we said, well, if this is the case, guys, we have to start training farmers on farm because that really works. And that's why we have now 500 trainers trained in the world doing these workshops, that you open your eyes. Why are these cows standing, not resting? Why is there not a crossover here? Why? Ask the why question. What was that? Reaction?
I said, because they are stood in their bed.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So how long did you stood in your bed last night when you came in your bed, right? You were standing in your bed with two front feet. Not very long. So normally you dive in within 2 seconds. And cows should lay down within 30 seconds in a bed. They need a little bit more time to check it. Look. Same with the water drinkers. They look, sniff, lick, test. Okay, and then they drink. It takes a bit more time. Same with resting. Okay, I'm in my bed here. Let's have a look. I saw a cow yesterday on the farm. She came in the bed, looking. No, backed up. Next cubicle, and then she went down within 30 seconds. We have some beautiful movies where they put 5 wet beds and 5 dry beds. And they let 4 cows in. All 4 picked a dry bed. And then they let the 5th cow in. And she was looking here, trying to kick one out, the other one out. Didn't work. Looking at the very last bed. Ah, there's my dry bed. And she was laying in the last 5th dry bed. Cows love dry beds, so you have to really make them clean and dry. We have trainers all around the world in 500 countries in 55 countries, and we really want to reach more people, and we're very much working now in Africa, Asia, to educate the world. They need the food even harder than we do. We are only exporting it. We're exporting 2/3 of all our assets in Holland from the agriculture. We also learned on farms that you should really use the eyes and the eyes and the ears and the brains of your workers. A lot of farmers say, well, they just work here to clean shit, or they just milk my cows. The moment you start taking your workers seriously and you ask them questions, that's how Toyota company went very big with a lean management structure. It's like just asking your workers, your co-workers, what can we do better? And then you have to give them the right tools to do it. And it's very simple things. If you look in CowSignals Training Company on Facebook, you find a nice movie I just made yesterday. This guy doing an excellent job cleaning the water troughs. But you have to have a brush, otherwise the water trough can't be cleaned. I was in Canada, they put a brush in every water trough, so you could open the water trough, there was the brush, pull the plug, wash it, and hang the brush back. So every trough had a brush. That you can do it during your normal cleaning round. That saves you an extra round. So how easy can you make your job? It's all about understanding how your staff is learning, and that's the people signals Tom was talking about. We want to have people learning, and they all learn in their own mode. And you see that most people like to see it. That's why we make picture books. But a lot of people like to just hear it from somebody else. And that's why we make videos. And some people want to do it. That's why we do workshops on the farm. And they want to do it and feel it and touch that rumen, and then you really start understanding. If you feel the wounds on the cow, you think, hey, this can't be right. These wounds are causing abortions. There's bacteria traveling through the wound in the bloodstream, Archaeobacterium pyogenes, so extra abortions with wounds. Number 2 abortion causes wounded cows. So do and feel it, and you get more aware of it, and you have to think about it and read it. That's why we make white papers. Under books, white papers, you can find a lot of free information on our website. How do you train staff? It's a very interesting thing. And how do you educate people? This is the simple method, the old-fashioned method, a carrot and a stick. This is the agricultural version with a fork. But you want to train them. But there was a lot of stuff now from on the internet. Daniel Pink has a very good TED talk, and he says if you first train your people, mastery, train them, give them skills, then the knowledge and the skills, then you can give them a purpose, which is a bit higher than just clean my rubbish or milk my cow. No, the purpose is we're trying to make milk for babies, or we're trying to make very healthy milk for our children. Or are we trying to keep our cows happy and healthy and want to have them one more year on the farm? We work on minimum labor, and we work on maximum health. And we want to have less sick leave from our workers and less sick leave from our cows. That is our aim. And you show the figures on the wall, and you tell them why you do it and how you do it. And now they have their skills and have a purpose in life. And now they will be very happy to get some responsibility. Oh yeah, I will do that. I can do this for you. And you give them responsibility, and they will do an excellent job for you. And these are the farms where the staff is happily staying for 10, 20 years. They don't want to leave anymore. So how can you treat your staff better? How can you get better results from your staff? This was actually a New Zealand farmer. He said to me one day, he said, well, when I have new staff, I give them a clipboard and a pen, and they come in and they say, okay, what can I do? Milk your cows and... So, well, yes, yes, but that's only tonight. This morning I'd like you to meet the staff. Oh, yeah, okay. So meet my wife, meet John and Henry. They work here too, and me. And there's another 300 of them down the driveway. Did you meet these girls? They work here too. Oh, yeah, yeah, I saw them. So I want you to go and meet them. What do you mean? Shake hands? No, that's not necessary. You just go there, and you're going to just sit in the field. You're going to sit in the middle of the field. And you just wait who comes to you. And you write down these five numbers that come to you, because these are your friends. They already like you. It's good to know who likes you. It's good to know who your friends are. So write down the five numbers of your friends. And then I'd like you to stand up, because it gets very busy then, very soon. Then you're going to check for the five biggest and the five smallest cows. And write down the numbers. And then the five most white and the five most black. And then you see... you look at a few more different things, and you write on all these numbers, and then you get to know them a bit better. But stay for 2 hours there, and also look at the ones that don't trust you yet, the ones in the back. You see, like Julie over there and Emily, they're too far away in the back, and they are sort of don't trust you. So what do? You walk up to them till you got the attention. Yeah, you see the attention is coming, and then you step two steps back. You start wiggling, and you say, morning, and then you walk to the next one, and you look at the next corner. Yeah, there's also a reaction. You see that one? Yeah, and then two steps back, and then you start wiggling a little bit. You say, morning, and then you go away. And the guy says, why do I do that? Well, it's very simple. If you do that, these cows feel that you're not a threat. So the first encounter with these animals is you're not a threat. And then the next time, they will be more easy. And if you never abuse them, they will slowly get your friend. Also, you have to think about this when you feed young baby calves, and when you wean calves, and when you calf cows. You never want to give them a bad experience, because they won't forget it. We made CowSignals coffee breaks now, every Monday, 5 minutes, with your staff, video. Just watch a little video. Let me do the talking, and you can discuss it with your staff. It's to inspire people around the world. We made a very successful 10 years continuous education program of video. People Signals is how to get people in action, and what kind of leader or manager are you? How can you get the maximum out of your staff? It's sensing, connecting, and leading. You have to have the right skills, and you have to always work in the balance between relation, organization, and information. You have to do the right things right. We give a lot of trainings on that. A few more practical things. This is fresh cows in Texas. What do you see? They stay 4 weeks in this herd, in this yard, and then they move after 4 weeks. What do you see? First 4 weeks after calving. You see dirty tails, and you see standing cows. And these 15 cows can't eat, so the bunk space is filled up. But you want to do every morning temperature check, and 10 times, and you want to do the tail paint, and you want to see... So you can't do that if there's no locker. And even worse, the fresh cows can't eat. They will eat less. If they can't eat with the herd, they will eat less. They have less meals per day. So you're losing it. So the simple solution is you just move out the 15, 20 cows that are in the fourth week after calving. They should be out in the next group, because you never overstock your fresh cows. Also, the dry cows before calving, you really want them to eat and never overstock them. We need 85 centimeter feed space for dry cows. If you don't have that, you're losing it. So very simple things, go at home and look at these three things. Do I have a soft D bed? And the question here, which one is the best? Bert Jan will answer that. There's no discussion anymore. Sand is the only good bedding for a cow, or the best bedding. If you have a slatted floor, you can't use sand very easily, so then you go for straw, or you go even for green recycled manure. It can be very good, but you need to make it very dry, 35% dry matter, and you have to fill it at least twice a week. And that's a bit more work, so in that order. Dry cows, if they don't rest enough, they don't eat enough. If they don't eat enough, they get ketosis. And we see in this research we do a half an hour less eating time. And we can already score them 42 days before calving. Is that amazing? We now know exactly which one of your five cows gets sick. Okay, you're 4 hours, okay? You get sick. So how do you feel about that? You're going to get sick. I know it, you know it. And what are you going to do now? So if you're going to buy your sensors, it only works if you're going to do something. And then I said, well, I don't even need a sensor. I just need one feeding place per cow. So let's first invest in one feeding place per cow. Still, you need a sensor because you want to have better fertility. You can't look at the cows all day or at night, so you still need a sensor. But with these health sensors, we get tremendous information. All the cows that are eating in half an hour less, they get ketosis. Dry cow resting time between 7 and 15 hours. Directly related with dead baby calves. If you have 14 hours resting, you only have 1 or 2% dead on arrival losses. If you have 8 hours resting time, you got 12% dead baby calves on arrival. You see the difference? There's a direct relation between resting time and stillbirths. On big Ohio dairies, the 20 days before calving, they measure exactly what's happening with these cows. So you really want your dry cows to rest and to eat. If you see this guy here, he's putting water for the cow and he puts feed on top of the cow. And he puts feed because then the cow starts licking the feed off. And we are cultivating this. I think, hey, wait a minute, this farmer does everything right. Top farm from the Netherlands. Bring water, bring feed, and put the feet on top of the baby calf. And the cow starts eating right away. So what he's doing, he makes sure that the cow starts eating right away, in the meantime licking the baby calf. So we think this is a very good idea. We saw it more times. So one of my university professors said, we have to do this. The cows always are looking for the baby. If you snatch calving and you pull them right away out for hygiene reasons and you put them somewhere else, the cow goes back to that little straw patch. Sniffing, and she starts eating the straw where the calf was just being born. So we're trying to cultivate this, and we use the power of nature. And the power of nature is actually a pamper pan and a cuddle box. So a cuddle box is where we put the baby calf right after calving, within the first minute, or whenever you pass by. It can be half an hour later. But you know, when she's calving, you're going to pick the baby as quick as you can, put her clean and safe in the box, and you put feed on top of her. Rubber bed, easy to clean, but you put feed on top of her, preferably TMR or even good quality hay. Then the cow will start licking the baby and eat her first meal. In the meantime, you milk her on this position. When the baby is there, now you milk the cow, and you give the colostrum to the baby. Why is this a winning system? Give me three arguments why we should do this. What do you think? This is a mobile cuddle box. We have different types. People keep sending me pictures, and I'd like you to send me your picture if you're going to do this. Everybody did this 50 years ago in a Thai stall. Pulling the baby out from the back, put the baby on top of the feet in the front, and we have excellent results. But we seem to forget about this. And if we do this right, we give them both an excellent start. Fresh colostrum from the mother, and fresh feed for the cow. And if you organize these two things, they only have to be here for half an hour, and then you've done all the jobs, and they can both go their own way, and they'll have an excellent start. Who thinks this is a good idea? Yeah? Who's going to do this? Who's going to try this tomorrow or next week? You only need a little box or a little crate. Try it, and I'd like you to send me a picture of it, okay? CowSignals.com, send me the picture. because we will make you famous. We put it in slideshows, we show it around the world. It's good for the marketing of your country, of your industry. We want to share good examples around the world. So you want to milk them here with a mini milker or a vacuum line, you can milk them here. And this is the best possible investment in your dairy. So again, deep bed, a good soft deep bed is one. Two is a stress-free calving line. And three is one feeding place per cow. And a good stress-free calving line, that includes the cuddle box here in this system behind this robot or milk parlor corridor. There's the stress-free calving line where we also put the cuddle box in. We look for labor efficiency and we look for all kind of improvements, more labor efficiency, and we see also a lot less replacements in our new dairies, and Bert-Jan is going to talk about that in a minute. We see that more resting is more milk, very simple. We see that doubling the lifetime of cows will cut your rearing cost for replacements into half. You can go for 3 cents per liter rearing cost instead of 6. So every liter you earn 3 pence more if you double the lifetime of your cows. And that's why we go for the optimum lifetime performance plan, because we think every farmer should be aware of this, and we are obliged to do this for the world. And we are obliged to do this for ourselves and for the cows. So it's good for you, good for the cow, and good for the world. And it's more fun. Always forgot about that. Less antibiotics, less disease, less work, more fun. So let's work on this together. We do this in China, and this is like 2,500 cows, 1, 2, 3, 4 buildings. They got 4 more on the other side, and they got 8 rotaries in the middle, in the 80 cow rotaries in the middle. We work with 20,000 cows in China. We work with 1 cow in Africa, and it works everywhere. Everybody needs this information. And it's I want you to help me to get it even also in the other 130 countries that we're not in yet. So I need your co-investment. You learn, I learn, we all learn, and we can also bring it to the developing countries. And my dad, he's putting more straw in. You see? Finally, after many, many years, he's putting more straw in, but he still doesn't trust his own straw, otherwise he would be on his knees, you see? He learned to do it like this. He never changed that old habit. And my son says, okay, Dad, how old is that cow? It's my neighbor farm. And he said, this cow is 8 years old. Okay, he says, then I can drink that milk. He wants to drink milk from happy old cows. I like to drink all the kids drink milk from happy old cows. And it doesn't feel right to drink milk from lame cows because it doesn't feel right. And that's an emotion, and emotion is also a reality. So we have to think about it, how we can do better in the dairy industry. Thank you very much. Questions?
Yeah.
I see some.
So, first question up there, do all things mentioned in your talk apply across all breeds of cattle?
Yeah, we see crossbreeds are a bit more durable. They seem to stand harsh situations better. So older breeds have less lameness and they have more meat on their body. The dual purpose cow, in 2 of my study groups with 10 farmers, the 2 dual purpose cows came out best. The old Dutch red cow, the MRI, was having the most money. They have meat and milk and have no disease. So they came out from all the farms as the best. They had the best income. If you look at it, crossbreeding, yeah, it's interesting. I think if your system is not good enough, if you're not willing to change the system to the cow, if you don't have the management skills or the knowledge to really take the Holstein cows, give them or the time to give them all the service, you probably should go for crossbreeding. So it's a choice. Either you have your Ferrari cow, or you have your double-purpose cow, and you have a less maintenance input.
We've done that one.
Shed design is for Bert-Jan, I think.
I think Bert-Jan actually put that question up.
Yeah. By design, shed design. Why do we not plan and engage a specialist at conception of the project? Who would put a house up without an architect? I think that's a real good point. Never, ever trust anybody but yourself. So don't trust any advice that is included in the products, because there's not an objective advice. So all the robot companies will give you a plan, but the plans are never good enough. We train these guys, but they are behind. We are far ahead from all the companies, all the robots companies. Also, any dairy barn design, we are smarter because we look at the cow and we look at the farmer, and we look at labor efficiencies. And most salespeople don't care about that. They just want to do the sale. And that's a really striking thing. How can you ever build a barn without having independent advice? That's still striking me. How can you invest $1 million without having a good advice? What else do we have, Tom?
Top one. Well, they're all.
If there's one change you think UK dairy farmers should make, what would it be? Deep soft beds. We went from 2% in Holland 18 years ago to 35% deep soft beds. So that took me 18 years push marketing. And you know, the profit from their own country, they don't listen to you. The whole world is listening to me, but in Holland, yeah, whatever, we make the beds very narrow and we put a mattress in. And you see that we now reach the point, the tipping point of 35% deep beds. So now if you say, hey, to your farmer's friends, yeah, I'm going to put a new barn, I'm going to put a mattress in. And they say, what, are you crazy? Now finally we get that stage. You have to put deep beds. It's a big mistake. Mattress should never be sold. Well, it's better than concrete. And it's foreseeing inside. But if I was in charge, I would ban them. Because they always see hog damage on mattresses. Unless you put 1 kilo of bedding on top of them. It can be dry manure, very good, nice, dry, separated manure, or a sand layer, or you put sawdust on top of it, but it has to be 1 kilo top quality sawdust, and that's too expensive. So then you're better off with a deep bed, it's cheaper. So you buy yourself a machine to fill the beds instead of investing in rubber mattresses. The rubber you need is on the milk parlor entrance and in the stress-free calving line on the floor, not in the beds.
Is it always true that better welfare drives better profit? Where's the cutoff point?
Yeah, good point. That is a very good point. People are asking me this question a lot, and Matt will tell you in a minute. Most of the time it is, but you have to look for the weakest spot first. If you're just going to build a paradise with golden taps, it's not going to pay back, right? But what do they really need? They need a place to rest, a place to eat, and a place to calf. And if you invest in these three, it will always pay back. If you have a poor system and you rubber the whole floor, it costs you a fortune, and it doesn't help you. It's only masking your lameness problem because it's a bit softer flooring. It costs you a fortune, and you're not solved the problem. So you have to do the first three things first, and these three things always pay back. More water, light, and air is a very good return on investment. Soft deep beds, stress-free calving line, and 1 feet place per cow really pay back.
How important it is observing herd hierarchy from a CowSignals perspective?
Very good question. Yeah. Going to the other one, how intelligent are cows? In my opinion, I think they are a lot smarter than us. So when I teach stress-free stockmanship, I say we have to learn how to read the body language of the cow. The cow will always be, that's what Bud Williams says in Texas, the cows will always be a lot. How good you're ever going to be in studying body language of cows, the cows will always be a lot better than you will ever be, because they are born with a natural body language stuff. We have to learn it. When we were Neanderthalers, a long time ago, 100,000 years ago, we were like, that's what we were 100,000 years ago. 5% of these genes is still in our system with the Homo sapiens, and we learn speech. But we didn't learn how to move and how to do body language. The Neanderthals were doing everything on body language. They were like cows. So now we have to open that last box up, the last 5% here that we still have somewhere, to learn body language of cows. And they're very intelligent, and they know what they want. They want to eat, rest, and calf. And they don't want to be bothered. I just wrote an article, if you don't bother the cows, how do you get 5 lactations? Don't bother your cows with the wrong things. Don't lock them in for 1.5 hours a day. Because it's a mistake, they only want to stand a half an hour up. And then they want to be resting and chewing. Don't stress the hell out of them when you catch them for milking, because they should be quietly chewing when they are waiting for the milking. And they should have maximum an hour milking time twice a day, or 3 times 6 minutes with a robot. So I really like robot farming.
19% replacement rate, so on the slide, due to fertility or health.
Yeah, good question, the first question. Because these cows in this new robot systems, one man does 150 cows, they only have they have 5 lactations, and the main reason is they don't get sick. So when the cow is resting and eating, it's like me. I rest and I eat, and I don't get sick until I die, hopefully. But that's what we do with cows. They don't get sick if you do an excellent job in your new system, soft bed, feeding place per cow, and stress-free calving line. And then the fertility is not an issue anymore. We call them the invisible cows. These cows are the invisible cows. And the 100,000 liter cows are sometimes a little bit longer to get pregnant. So they sometimes enlarge their own calving interval. They just get pregnant a bit later, but they're still invisible. You might have 3 inseminations, but they always get pregnant. You don't see them, and they always give you milk. So all the cows can be very happy and healthy.
And
last one.
How do I get onto a CowSignals training course to learn more?
Very good question. Call the guys from Moor Valley. They do all kind of practical trainings. You're also very welcome in Holland, where we do 4-day trainings with herd managers and vets, feed advisors, mixed groups. Very, very good learning. Or you can ask one of our consultants to join on your farm. But the best thing is actually do it online or do it live. Well, live is the best, no discussion. So get 5 or 10 people together or sign in at Moor Valley for training. Robots of future, yes, I think for sure, because the labor is getting more expensive. So we see that in Holland we have 25% milk robots already. What's the difference in line between indoor and outdoor herds? Very good question. 14 hours rest and 6 hours eating and 10 hours chewing. And from the 14 hours resting time, roughly, I have to say it right, cows are resting in the barn 14 hours. In the field, they rest a little bit less because they eat 10 hours. They need less time for rumination. So they have in the field, they have 10 hours busy with eating. In the barn, only 6 hours. So in the field, they have more time to get the ration in. It's like slow food. And they have to all nibble it from the ground. If they can eat it rapidly, they have more time to rest and to chew. The total chewing time is the same. It's 10 hours rumination and 6 hours chewing. And in the field, it's the other way around. Because they eat shorter grass, they have less rumination and more eating time. Okay? I'm just right in time, 12:15.
Do you want to do these? One more minute.
One more minute. Okay. Joep, if you can, a heifer. Okay, they're coming from the Twitter stream. Joep, if you can, a heifer group will give you 10% more milk from heifers. If you can, a heifer group will give you 10% more milk from heifers and less losses. Yeah, it's true. If you can, make a heifer group, because it's true. 10%, the main reason is they're not bothered by big mamas, and they can just eat and rest whenever they want. Clean cubicles 3 times a day, the last one there. I couldn't see exactly what was on there. You might put it back, but clean cubicles 3 times a day. People think we have no time for that, but you have to do the right things on your dairy. And do you do the right things? Always right. A lot of people are doing the things right. The things they do right. They milk correctly, they do everything correctly, but they're not doing the right things. And I'm thinking about that every one and now and again. Am I doing the right things? Should I be here standing talking to you, or should I be working with the supermarkets to make every farmer in the world go for video learning and every staff member in the world? Because I think this is a necessary training. We have the same discussion with vets, my own group. They say, well, we can't learn anything, but we know everything already. But that's not the case. You have to keep learning every year. And if you open up for that, then you can really learn a lot. And education is the key. So am I doing the right things? Are you doing the right things? You have to think about what you can do better. But you really, 3 times a day cleaning the bed is really helping your cell count go down. It's only a little job. You don't have to do a full job, like every detail. No, just walk by at noon before you go for lunch with your little tool, and just clean out a few manure pads, and that's all you do, and you already lower your cell count. And the best farmers, especially the robot farmers, they learn to do it 4 times. They do it again at 10 o'clock in the evening. So they push up the feet, and then they make a quick round between the cow, only a short round, but they have seen a few heats, a few dirty cows, a few lameness they're going to check tomorrow morning. So they actually have the extra observation round. And they go between the cows because it's so easy. You need your good boots. Even these barns are well ventilated, so they just go quickly between the cows before they go to bed. I wouldn't do this in a pig farm because your wife wouldn't let you in bed anymore. Okay, guys, maybe one last movie. Is it running? No, it's not running. Come on, baby. Maybe we have to stop. Why is it not running? Ah, it's going. Okay, you have some sound on it. This was Tom on holidays in Italy. It's Tom Hoff, he was in Italy on holidays. He changed a bit now. But he was asking what time is it. I said, well, it's actually 17:35. Okay. Are you sure? Okay. Yeah. 36, okay.
Grazie.
Grazie, prego. Thank you. So Tom went shopping, he came back half an hour later, and he was still thinking about this guy with the balls of the donkey.
Ha mangiato il ciuchino, eh?
Hey, he was eating, the donkey. Oh. Yeah.
Senta, mi sa dire che ore sono adesso?
Tell me, what time is it now? Again? Well, okay, if you really want to know.
7:15.
A quarter past seven.
Huh? Ma sono le 7:15.
How do you know?
Incredibile.
How can you say incredible by lifting the balls of the donkey? How can you read it from the donkey balls?
Sotto c'è il campanile, vedi? 7:15.
Okay, guys, always look at the signals. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you, Joep. Brilliant as ever.